Let's talk about Trisha Paytas. Hey everyone, welcome back to the podcast. My name is Brittany Simon. If you're listening on Spotify, thank you very much. And if you're I cannot talk today. I'm just going to tell you right now, I feel like a hot mess. If you're on Patreon, thank you for that as well. All right, oh my gosh. I did not plan for this to be today's episode, but if you guys have been following the Trisha Paytas H3H3 fallout, I think it's important that we talk about it, especially since the last few podcasts have really built a really solid foundation, I think, for being able to observe sort of the nuances of mental illness, hopefully. Before we jump in, to my left, I have a family tea, a traditional tea. This is the Ahmed tea. I'm sure many of you have heard of it. It's in like every Arabic store you go to. It's not always boxed like this though. This is very different. This says Ahmed tea London. So I assume this is just like the London branding, but I usually get it in a box. But either which way, it comes in a tin can. This is our loose Arabic tea. I know many of you know I'm Middle Eastern, but for those of you who are new, hi, hello. My parents are from Iraq, and tea, or we just call it chai, is a very important pastime. We do it in the morning, in the afternoon, in the evening. I personally drink it either throughout the day or if I'm skipping tea for the day. You know, it is what it is. But for the most part, there's usually always chai on my stove. So this, I want to show it to you. I don't know. You can see it pretty good, right? So this, it's full of tea, so I don't want it to spill. But this is a dedicated teapot to this particular tea. You guys have seen me drink lots of teas from lots of people, and normally you would put tea leaves inside of a strainer and then let it seep. Well, for this Arabic tea, for the way I was raised drinking chai, you boil your leaves in the water and you leave them in there. So in my house, like, that is just, there's a lot of loose tea leaves in there. Now, for whatever reason, when I pour my tea, I don't usually get tea leaves. Some people do, I don't. I drink it with milk, so my tea right now has like this much milk in it, like half the glass, because your girl like her milk. But a lot of people drink chai black or with honey or sugar. It's totally up to you. And then you'll notice maybe the packaging, just a little cardamom is a huge, like, it's a huge thing in Middle Eastern food and our chai and our, it's just a flavor we really like. So if you guys are interested, walk into your local Arabic store and check out Ahmed tea. It's really, really good, and I highly recommend it. Okay. Are y'all ready for this? If you guys don't know who Trisha Paytas is, if you don't know who H3H3 is, maybe this isn't the episode for you, so leave a like and a comment and go about your day. But if you guys are interested and been following their fallout, I think you and I might have a really good conversation. So check out on my YouTube page, guys, on the community tab, for those of you who don't even know it exists, because honestly, sometimes I am shocked at how much I did not use this before I really discovered what it was for. But the community tab is super useful. And one thing I did is I made a long post. God, I made such a dumb long post. It's just a reflection on watching Trisha go kind of like, meh. And one of the things I just want to keep in mind is that, you know, your mental illness is an explanation for your behavior, but it's not an excuse. But how do you know when you're in a mental illness episode that you're the one being unreasonable? I think that's the dilemma we all have, is how do we know we're the ones being unreasonable, right? So I said the issue with mental illness, you think you sound really, really reasonable. You think you sound so on point, but you don't make sense when you talk. Do you notice that when Trisha starts becoming on edge, she'll do a thing where she'll say, this isn't about money. This isn't about money. This has nothing to do with money. And then the whole conversation is now surrounded by money. In her case, the 5% debacle.
We are producing the show and I'm taking a cut. I feel like that's beyond reasonable.
All the highlights.
Reasonable.
5%. Yes. 5%. Do you realize how much 5% was of our last one? That should be enough. But also, like, highlights. And then you weren't the membership I had to fight for because you weren't, you're like, oh, I forgot to tell you about the members. Like,
I giving you crazy. 50% of all the members, even though we work and do all the work. I don't know why you fight me on money. The deal you have is reasonable.
Okay.
No, but I feel like a lot of frustration you have about everything with the.
Frustrated. Bringing stuff up, you get defensive. I'm not frustrated.
If you guys do not know the story in detail, it's not important. What's important is that when a person is mentally ill and they latch on to one concept and they stick to it and they hound it into the ground, it makes them feel really, 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 really confident in what they're talking about. But that's why normal people or people with, you know, neurotypical brains, when they see this, they're just like, you're either being rude or a jerk or an asshole. Because if you don't have a mental illness and you're acting like this, this is what we call an asshole. So the question is, if we acknowledge Trisha Paytas has a mental illness, do we give her leeway with her behavior? One of the things she said on Twitter, which I know she's deleted a lot of tweets within the last 48 hours, her and Ethan had a big fight last night on the internet, but one of the things that I think is significant about Trisha's behavior is that she'll say, this isn't a BPD thing. This isn't my mental illness. This is me being sure about my what I want from this job, which is more creative power in the podcast Frenemies, which is what she does with Ethan. The problem is that she became initially, if you guys know the whole story, she kind of like slowly dragged into Ethan's group. And you'll notice, no offense to how she came about being a part of their family, but it hasn't necessarily been the most healthy thing. But because they're relatively healthy as a family, give or take a few details, they've invited her and been a stable place for her. But the problem with borderline especially is that because it is such a fear of abandonment, right? She feels like she's had all this time with Ethan, all this time he's been white knighting her and inflating her ego, not holding her truly accountable, in my opinion, which has allowed her to feel really safe, which is good. But in turn, when she acts out or when they criticize her even a little bit, it becomes an attack, a fear of abandonment, and it escalates. So the question is, if this isn't a mental illness issue and she's just genuinely sure she deserves more creative power in this situation, then we need to treat her like a neurotypical person. And in that case, she's being a jerk and should be fired. She insulted the crew, the people. She discussed business on a public podcast. All of the actions that her and Ethan do, you know, it's very YouTube, but it's not really business savvy all the time. One of the strengths and power Ethan has had is making sure that this production is his baby. He's put in all the money up front. He pays the people who are there to do the work. And you'll see, you know, Trisha does this thing where she says, oh, well, I have camera crew. I could hire my sister. I could bring in my people. No offense to Trisha. I don't trust her people, and I'm a viewer. You think Ethan's going to trust your people? No offense to Trisha, but because she's the unstable one, she doesn't get to say what they should do in terms of business if Ethan's the one putting up all the money for the production, and no offense, has kept it afloat. Ethan isn't the one who has stormed off and almost quit this podcast three times. Ethan isn't the one with a severe mental illness that switches without any warning. Though, if you guys watched the last Frenemies podcast they did, she started off the podcast stating she was in a bad mental place, stating she was on her period. You could tell she was trying so hard to be enthused about, you know, that podcast that day. But it's really, you know, and I say this when I say you need to know yourself in order to really help the people around you and yourself. Trisha still doesn't understand her own triggers. She doesn't know when she's triggered. She has no clue. Because she's really doubling down right now, which makes sense because she is triggered. But the thing that's important is that even while you're triggered, you got to get to the point where you know you're being triggered. So, how do we get to that point? It's not necessarily how much therapy you've had, right? Because I had very few sessions. It's not necessarily how much you know about the mental illness in a very like academic way, because I would argue my therapist knew better than I did, right? It's more like how you know yourself in relation to this mental illness. It's so interesting, though, how the internet can really be the best and worst thing for you. There were so many comments saying, Trisha's so valid. Ethan's a jerk. He's been trying to trigger her. Ethan's the problem. The thing is, though, and I know this sounds really hard for people who are mentally ill to understand, you are the one with the problem. Neurotypical people are not the people with problems. We are. And so we have to do more work than they do because we're the ones with the challenge, not them. You know what I mean? I know we're living in America where everything's really privileged and amazing and rich. And we think that because the system is so rich, it should take care of its people. But that's not really how humans operate. Humans operate to the best of their ability. And to argue that our government is working at it, you know, to its best ability to help everyone is just kind of like silly. But the important thing is that you understand where you're living and what time you're living and what access you have. Trisha is an incredibly positioned position. She's in an incredibly privileged position. She has every reason to get help. She says she's in therapy. She says she's on meds. Here's the thing. I never needed meds for borderline. I don't even know what meds they take for borderline. When I had my therapist who helped me through DBT, she told me, look, if you're open to meds, that's great. Let's worry less about meds and focus on getting better. We never went towards meds. She never even suggested it. And I loved that. I loved that she didn't want to push big pharma onto me and get me addicted to another pill like the rest of America, right? And at the same time, sometimes our mental illnesses are so severe, our medication is our lifesaver, and we should be grateful the science has moved so far as to provide that. So what do we do, guys? What do we do? Well, we move with compassion. It's so funny. You know, last night I went to sleep and I felt anxiety for Trisha. This morning I feel drained, and not just because I'm watching her spiral in a way that I, you know, and I see myself in her, but a part of me like also doesn't see myself in her. And a big distinguishing factor between people who are mentally ill in two categories, I think there is a distinguishing factor between the two kinds of mentally ill people. And I don't mean in terms of the severity of your mental illness, because that's not my place to like judge, but like the knowledge you have in your own head. I really think being well-read saved my life. I do think Trisha doesn't have enough knowledge. You've heard her and Ethan talk about politics, talk about gay rights. When Trisha talks about gay rights, it drives me crazy because it is so ill-informed, right? And what's ironic is that the thing that the internet defended Trisha about was her going about LGBT rights and how Ethan dismissed her and how it's super important to her. No offense to Trisha, her journey into LGBTness is a very specific kind of journey.
Death for being gay in Texas. And then the wife, played by Anne Hathaway, like I think she was in on it at the end because she calls.
Not much changed since then in Texas, I don't think.
I know, but that's what I'm saying. That's what's so. Okay, I'm not trying to get all like heated about this, but there's still. People are still like that. Like trans people are getting beat in their face to death.
No, I'm
like,
so over that shit.
And so, like, watching it, I was just like, holy shit. And like Heath Ledger, Jake Gyllenhaal said Heath Ledger refused to make like gay jokes about it, like during the Oscars and. I don't know.
Is there a third pizza?
You're so not good about this. Okay, let's go to your stupid. I don't like this segment. Just for the record, fan advice is a stupid segment.
Why?
But we can do it. It's so dumb. What's the point?
Okay. She's a person who feels like she should be in this community and be about this community, but she isn't about this community. They didn't even know why Pride existed. So she can't really say she's a part of the greater community, but she can say she's a part of the LGBT community. Just not like the political one, maybe not the historical one. It's just really hard for me to sit here and listen to them talk about how Pride, like, why was Pride there? I don't know. Why did, and then Ian had to literally, or was it Ian or Dan? One of them, Dan maybe? One of them had to literally inform the two hosts about what Pride was for. So you like, stay with me here, right? We're dealing with super uneducated people. And so the problem is that uneducated people do two things with their mental illnesses. They use it to make money or it ends up destroying them. Trisha has managed to monetize her mental illness, just like Gabby Hanna and the rest of YouTube. You know, it was so funny because someone told me on my live show yesterday that I don't really think you were ever an SJW. One of my five friends told me that. He goes, I don't really ever think you were because you were so open to knowledge. And the truth is the distinguishing factor between when I was an SJW and when I wasn't is how I use that knowledge. So when I was in Seattle and I was super mentally ill, I was coming out of conservatism. I was so struggling because no one would validate my mental illness in my family. Nobody understood. My sister was a huge advocate for me, which is ironic because she is the advocate. But my sister was a huge help, my best friend, the one you saw in the Q&A yesterday, huge help, but they didn't know what it was. They just thought I was depressed or anxious or nervous or depressed or suicidal because I was queer in a very like anti-queer home. Nobody knew I had borderline, so they didn't know how to help me. And so when I was in Seattle, one of the things that really helped me initially was how validating people were. People were really like, your emotions are valid, your feelings are valid. Yes, we all struggle from mental illness. And it felt so liberating until it was my destruction, until the constant validation never encouraged me to get better. People advocated for therapy but didn't go, or they went, but they'd been going for so long, it made me feel like it obviously doesn't work. Like, I don't think you should be in therapy for your whole life unless you have a super serious mental like issue, which is fine. But I knew myself. I knew I wasn't that bad because for the most part I was functioning, but there were times when I would switch, and it usually came about with very specific triggers. Oh, I gotta move my legs. Oh, they're so, oh my god, the circulation is painful. Hold on. Oh my god. Okay. Oh, that was such, ow. That was a horrible experience. The shot. I have sciatica, I think. So I'm pretty sure. I haven't gotten formally diagnosed, but it runs in my family. And at this point, I'm pretty sure that's what it is. Oh, my gosh. Okay, so in Seattle, it just felt really good, right? And then I lost my job. And I was like, okay, what's happening? And then people blamed my relationship. Oh, it's the person you're dating. And I was like, no, it's not that. Now, it wasn't the person I was dating. I had borderline. But the person I was dating at the time triggered the borderline heavily because he was a chronic liar and he had his own mental illnesses, and his mental illness like triggered my mental illness. And so basically I had to move on from him. I had to completely block him from my life eventually. And that was just what it was. But that changed. Once I got rid of all these people in my life that were either liars or contradicted reality to me so severely with no openness that they could be wrong, my life became stable again. I got therapy. I traveled. I got closer to my family. I bonded. I went back home. I ended up rebuilding my whole life. But so much of that is the fact that I got diagnosed as high functioning. I got the thing that was significant was that my therapist asked me if I had a job. And I was like, yeah, of course I have a job. Who doesn't have a job? And then she was like, well, most borderlines can't hold down a job. And I said, really? And she's like, yeah, you know, they get very overwhelmed. They feel triggered at work. They feel like they always have to change their environment to start over new. And I was like, oh, well, I definitely do that. I'm as a child, I moved 12 times. And then as an adult, I've probably moved another 20. Like, I've moved a lot in my life. I've traveled. I've gone places. Anytime I don't feel good, I just get up and go. Now, I've found a place where I'm establishing myself. I'm hopefully going to buy a home here. You know, I have a lot of goals where I am now, but I could not have been this person if I wasn't open to being somebody who could be wrong. I know this sounds crazy, but because Trisha holds down a job, my head wants to put her as high functioning. And because she self-sabotages in a way that is actually sort of monetarily beneficial to her, a part of me feels like she's strategic. But I know she's not being completely strategic. But there is a time when you're manic, when you're sort of a genius and crazy. And so a big part of me observing her is acknowledging that she is in the throes of her mania. And at the same time, seeing how she's being strategic with it, that makes me think she's high functioning. So it makes me want to hold her more accountable. But she doesn't have the knowledge, like the reading knowledge, my Ty Lopez impression here. She doesn't have the knowledge, you know, to actually get her to the next step. She says she's in therapy. She says she's on meds. I hate to say this, and I don't mean it in the way that it sounds, but it's going to sound this way to some people. So what? If it's not working and helping, maybe it's not good enough. But let me give you a slither of hope. Trisha is getting better. And we know this for two reasons. The consistency of her, or frequency rather, of her episodes have gone down. So that's really good. And the second thing was the way she handled the end of this last podcast. Self-aware, she said, Ethan, I want to end this podcast. And he goes, I can end this podcast when you walk away. And she goes, no, I need to end this. So she says, I don't want to be the person who always walks off. She's well aware of her actions and how they impact people's idea of her.
We got to stop for real. Really. Okay. We need to stop. Please. Okay.
Whenever you're ready, you can walk away.
So. No, because I don't want to title this.
It's Trisha. The pizza curse.
But can we just
edit it out? I'm not going to title it Trisha's thing. It's the pizza curse. It is.
Mm-hmm.
We shouldn't have got pizza. Pizza? Oh no, it was pizza. Trisha, let me just say, I'm sorry.
Ethan, that you just did that. You're right. Nothing's wrong with you. You don't know how much therapy I go to a week. I go to four Zoom sessions a week.
No, I understand.
Ethan, what you just said was, you're right, Trisha. Everything's fine. That's insane. Like, the fact that you did that to me is like,
it's
insane.
It's not insane. We're friends. We're having a friendly conversation. I shouldn't have to walk on eggshells around everything I say.
All right, Ethan, I'm asking to end this. I'm asking.
You can leave anytime, Trisha.
But then you're making this thing where we're not ending the show and you get to sit here and be like, okay, well, that just happened and you're eating pizza and then
I will end the show the minute you walk off.
All right, so let's just end it. Please, thank you guys for watching. And I don't want it to be a thing where you're just sitting here eating pizza and you become a meme.
So then I'll say, I'm sorry.
Okay.
Obviously, I don't want to get in an argument over your emotions. Okay, all right, we're done. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Second, I just want to point out that Ethan, for business, doesn't, you know, I assume, I don't know why he quite did that, right? Except to say that Ethan, I don't hold him accountable for knowing everything about borderline or mental illness, but Ethan has a harder time reading the room than maybe other people. But at the same time, he was aware that she was upset. He just didn't know in which way. And that's the dilemma. When you have a person who tells you, I'm not upset, and then you're looking at them and you're like, you're obviously upset. It seems like gaslighting when they tell you, I'm not upset, and you're like, I know you're upset because you're doing that passive aggressive thing. And that's the problem. With inner circle people, you should be able to say, are you being passive aggressive against me? Versus with maybe people who are your friends or loosely a part of your inner, like people you know, maybe you'll be more hesitant. So she was self-aware, and I think he was self-aware, but I think they wanted different things from each other in that moment. She wanted her Ethan, who's her white knight, and Ethan wanted somebody who could fucking come to work and have a, like, do their job. And at the same time, I believe both of them were sort of irritated during that podcast. I noticed that both of them were on edge, and I assume there's a lot of reasons for that. But Trisha is getting better, and you could see at the end of the podcast, for just a split second, when Ethan is ending the podcast, she has like a face. It's like her disassociative face, but it's not quite there yet. And she can tell she's about to fucking get triggered, like real triggered. So borderline, because I don't know how other mental illnesses work, but with at least with borderline for me, there's like steps to being really borderline triggered. The first step is just normal people stress. See, normal people feel stress and then they get over it. When I feel stress, I'm like, first step to getting triggered. So note to self, Brittany, get rid of this stress. I don't have the luxury of being stressed for many, many days. I have to squash it within 24 hours or within 72, I will 100% have a borderline episode. So when Trisha gets up from the chair, you can see her face is like, I'm not upset. And then it falls because she's breaking. And I get that. I know what that's like. I feel so like overwhelmed just watching it happen. It's so much stranger seeing it happen to somebody. And you're like, stop it, stop it, stop it. Like, stop it right now. My issue I have primarily with how this all gets handled is that the key to like borderline or even like slightly narcissism, because we know Trisha tested really high in the narcissistic scale with Dr. Drew. My concerns is that This thing she's doing, posting and tweeting and stuff, this is what I would do to my inner circle. I wouldn't do it to the internet. I would post on the internet crying videos and mania, and I'll do a whole borderline thing about this. But the thing I would do to my friends was what she does to Twitter. Trisha has no friends. And the only friend she has is Ethan. And instead of just talking to Ethan, she has to go to the internet. Because for Trisha, she's built a validation backup that is the internet. Her comment section is so toxically validating her. Not all of it, but a large portion of them are like, this is so valid. This is a woman knowing what she wants. Guys, stop. Stop with this pseudo-feminism bullshit. Stop with this Tumblr, I am a woke woman, I need no man bullshit. Stop. Sometimes your feelings are pieces of shit. Like, sometimes you have bad feelings. Sometimes your feelings are not valid. Sometimes they're happening because, you know, it's happening. But you cannot just validate bad behavior because it makes sense to you if you want someone to get better. Now, here's the difference. And this is what I want you to hear me when I say this. Trisha is not a bad person to me. I have no problem with Trisha Paytas. Do I think she doesn't make moral decisions or ethical decisions? Sure. But like, she has no ethical, no value system. She has literally no reason to ever be anything other than what she is, which is a person in motion. Have you ever noticed that Trisha is constantly worried about money, even though she's a multimillionaire? It's because she knows ultimately that this won't last forever. And she knows ultimately that people love drama. Look at me today, guys. I am a part of the problem. I literally had a different podcast planned. And then the Trisha thing, I can't get out of my head, to the point where now I've dedicated my time talking about a mentally ill person because I'm seeing chaos around me and I want to comment on it. But if Trisha was getting better, we would stop talking about her. She also had a skincare line launch like that day, which was so interesting. Okay, this is the funny thing about it. When Trisha put out that skincare commercial, I thought it was funny because it was self-aware that her skin is fucked up and she's obviously using a bunch of filters in the video to hide her bad skin. But then during the H3H3 podcast, she doubled down and was like, no, my skin is really good though. I could take off my makeup right now and it'd be amazing. But later in the triggered episodes, during the last 48 hours, like literally the last 48 hours, she showed her skin and it's still fucked up. This is her diet primarily and the fact that this girl is not drinking enough water. There's no way. Because I'll tell you, I had shit skin most of my life. Especially when you're stressed and everything is happening. And one of the things that help, like I don't wear foundation. I don't even own foundation anymore. The things I've realized that affect my skin are these skin products. They tell you that are good for you and they're just fucking up my skin. I'm not saying everyone's skin, but my skin. And two, your diet and your stress. And everyone knows Trisha's unhealthy. So it's like, girl, you don't need to launch a skincare line if you're advocating that this product works, but we can see your skin in the middle of your BPD episode on the internet and it's not clear. And like, that's the thing. She is living in a fantasy land where she gets on H3H3's, like the Frenemies podcast, and literally says, oh, I could take off my makeup right now and my skin would be clear. While saying she got a chemical peel and her skin was peeling. Like, the girl doesn't live in a consistent reality where she is allowed to be a fuck up unless she decides she's a fuck up. If anyone else calls her a fuck up, it's the end of the road. If she calls herself a fuck up, it's valid. She says she doesn't want to be rude to like the staff, then proceeds to be rude, right? She hates the idea of people saying she's not a good person, but Trisha isn't really a great person. Like she's not a bad, evil, malicious person, but she's not stable. And so the reason I give leeway to a lot of people with mental illness is not because, you know, not just because I have one and I've been there, but because I can kind of gauge for the most part when a person is being genuinely destructive in a way that impacts more than just themselves. And Trisha, for the most part, really just impacts herself. And if you watch Trisha Paytas videos about transness and think that what she says matters about your community or your identity, then that's on you. Because nobody reasonable or logical would watch Trisha Paytas and take her seriously. And so when you start to take her seriously, it inflates her ego and reminds her, see, I can manage. Even with a mental illness, I get to be a voice of reason. But the question is, why? Why are we taking her seriously? And that's the issue I have, because she's successful. Because no matter how much we want to paint it around it, we love people who have money and are successful. And because Trisha is, we're validating her choices. What does Trisha always say when people have an issue with her OnlyFans? Well, I'm a millionaire. Well, I make money. Okay, Trisha, what does that have to do with anything? And it only, I get it, has to mean something when we're talking about success in terms of America, because America values money. We think in America, if you succeed to get money, even if you're fucked up, that just proves that you can beat the statistics, which is true. But see, Trisha uses her fucked upness to exploit it to make that money. So the question isn't really, can you defy the statistics in America economically? We know you can. The question is, what do you do after you make it and you're still not stable and money isn't enough? Trisha obviously has a spending addiction / eating addiction / obviously needs constant validation. Like, one of the worries, right, of watching her public life do its thing is that people who often are willing to do these things are not people with great sets of value systems. And this is important, guys. Think about it. Who goes on these shows of like My 600-Pound Life or My Addiction or Honey Boo Boo? Like, who are these people? And you know what's worse is that these normal people get pulled into these shows, get famous for a time, don't know what to do with that money. And then when they get thrown back into their normal life because nobody wants to watch them anymore, they end up getting into drugs or depression or worse off than when they started. So that's the dilemma too. If you don't know how to utilize your fame, it's just going to destroy you. And it's one of the reasons why, again, Joe Rogan says this, you really don't want to become famous until you're at least in your 30s, or at least to some extent when you're stable. It can really be damaging, not for everyone, but for most people. We've seen a great impact in child fame, and Trisha's had this goal because her life has been so fucked up for most of it. Though I'm not sure how many of her stories can really be validated, given that she is a chronic liar, I'm not sure, but listen to this is important. I'm not saying Trisha is a chronic liar and knows she's lying. I'm saying Trisha tells stories, and I don't know how many of it is in her head and how much of it happened. And the reason I say this is because if you do have one of these like mental illnesses, right, like these personality disorders, the issue you're going to find is that you have to be able to learn, and this is what DBT taught me, to learn when I'm actually being accosted, when someone's actually trying to fight me, and when I feel like someone's trying to fight me. So, hold on. Oh my God, this episode, guys. I hope you don't feel drained. I feel emotionally drained today. And a big part of that is just, again, the problem with, like, some of you reached out to me and they're like, talk to Trisha. Trisha's never going to listen to me. Ethan's not going to listen to me. Like, these people are not going to listen to somebody that, you know, they have enough resources. They're rich enough to have better resources than just me. But the dilemma between, how do I say this? The dilemma between like modern therapists and maybe just like a person like me is that I'm not interested in judging Trisha. I'm really not interested in even like as a YouTuber, I'm not trying to judge Trisha in a real way. I'm not, again, I like her. I think Frenemies is a really good combination of people who need each other. But I also think it's the reason why dependent relationships are so toxic. Because it, you know, they often depend on a lot of validation. My bestie of 22 years who was just on, one of the things that we, like, okay, so if I go to her and I say, hey, you know, I'll ask her a question about myself. One where the answer might hurt my feelings. And so she might give me the, what I call the safe answer first. And then I'll look at her and I'm like, no. Give me the real, like unfiltered answer. Just like say it. I need to hear it. And then my best friend will give me that unfiltered answer. Here's the key. If she gave me another fake answer, like another PG answer, another somewhere I'm walking around you answer, it could possibly get me to the point where I'm going to feel triggered because I'm like, you don't trust me and I can't trust you if you're not going to tell me the truth. The job of my inner circle is to tell me the truth. The job of like strangers and friends is to mind their own business. Like if they're not in the inner circle, unless I ask them. But my inner circle, their job is to tell me the truth. And that's why I go to certain ones. As an example, I will go to my friend of 22 years or my sister for insight before I'll go to like my mom. I love my mom. But because my mom believes in God a lot, when she gives me answers to my life, it's always through the lens of religion. Hold on, I'm gonna sneeze. And because it's through the lens of religion, sometimes it can close to trigger me. It doesn't quite anymore. I've learned to stop it. But when people defy reality in the way that it's clearly in front of me, it fucks me up. Now, borderline, from my understanding, is like it's a misunderstanding of like thought patterns in your head, meaning humans process emotion first and then logic, but borderlines get stuck on the emotional. So when we're talking, every human processes, right? Oh, like a person said something. I feel something about it. Squash it. How do I think about it? Borderlines go, I feel this way about what they've said, and then they write it all the way into the ground, right? So it's important for me when I'm with people, if I'm starting to feel that way, to go, where am I? Who am I? Am I safe? Then why am I freaking out? And then to move myself through those steps. Now at this point, I can basically see it coming. I know my limitations. I'm working on learning more of my limitations as life proceeds forward and shows me all of these interesting possibilities I never considered. Like I was heavily considering a long distance relationship, one where I traveled a lot with my partner. And then I realized I can't do that. As much as I'd love to be a Brittany that travels the world and is super go with the flow while she's establishing like a family and kids, I can't do that. When I'm single, it's a little different. That way, if I'm moving and I'm out of my comfort zone, it triggers me. At least I'm alone and I'm hurting myself. But if I have kids or people who are responsible, I'm responsible for, I do need a lot of consistency. And I'm going to follow the tenets of like traditional Middle Eastern upbringing, which is like aunts, uncles, grandpas, grandmas. Family helps you with your kids. You know, I fully expect to live next to my farm brother for the rest of my life to whatever extent, because I fully expect to call my sister-in-law at one point and be like, hey, I need you to babysit my kids because I need a day off. And I do the same for her. When she's feeling overwhelmed, Auntie Brittany is here. That is what I am for. We are here as family members to help each other. We don't, you know, participate in daycare facilities, and not that I'm against them. I just personally have worked enough in them when I was going through college for child development. I dropped out of college, but when I was doing it and I had to observe these facilities, again, it's like therapy. It's not an environment where I would put my child because they can't hug, kiss, show affection, love my child individually. And studies have shown children who aren't hugged are you know, they grow up with like a lot of problems. So I know it's more deep than that, but I'm just giving you an example. So I want to make sure that when my children are coming up, they're with family, people who can hug them and love them and reaffirm who they are and, you know, with them. And I know what you're saying. Molestations and rapes happen amongst family members. Of course. Vet your family. I'm not trying to be ignorant, you know? I'm not trying to be ignorant. So, you know, we all got a family member or two who's a little sketchy. But I, you know, I just keep my kids away from sketchy people. You know what I'm saying? So, again, we aren't trying to condemn Trisha or mentally ill people. We're trying to acknowledge that all of it is on a spectrum and all of us are doing it differently in different ways. One of the things I've noticed is there is a few people in my audience who infantilize me. Anytime I have a bad day, they assume it's borderline related. And it's not a lot of the time. A lot of the time it's PTSD related or just anxiety and stress or just normal people stressed. And so I always have to reassure them I'm not having an episode. I'm literally just normal people stressed and I'm going to squash it in the butt before this day ends. But the problem is that once you are sick, once people know you're sick, the first thing they go to is she must be showing her sickness. So Trisha, understandably, was probably overly triggered even more because during that conversation, she was like, I am not having a border. Like, I'm not triggered. I'm not upset. And the problem is Ethan goes, you are upset. So here's the thing. Trisha, up until that point, when she said, I'm not upset, Trisha was, she also followed it with saying, if I was upset, I'd storm out.
That's not what it is.
That's what you said.
So then that's, but, I don't remember, but that's
gaslighting
not what
is telling someone how they feel, and you're telling me how I feel, and I'm telling you I don't feel frustrated or upset. So I don't know what else that could be. How am I gaslighting you by telling you I'm not feeling this way? How is that gaslighting you? I'm not feeling this way.
Okay.
I wouldn't show up. I wouldn't come here. I would, you know,
Listen, you can be upset and not,
but I'm not.
Because there's a, you can be upset and then also not be like, I'm not showing up. Fuck you.
I'm
like,
not
there's
upset.
Levels.
If okay. I was upset, I
well,
wouldn't show up.
I'm just explaining. I'm just, because you can be upset and still show
but
up.
But I'm not upset. And that's
okay.
What gaslighting
right.
is. Because you're
okay.
saying I'm gaslighting
I'm
you
gaslighting
by saying.
You. You're not upset. You're perfectly,
oh, wow.
you're in a perfect condition right now.
Okay. Wow. Holy cow. That's crazy. I mean, I don't know how you, I just don't see what you just did. That's really
what
crazy.
Did I do?
We have to end it now. Like, really.
What did I do?
We got to stop for real. Really,
okay.
So there's a spectrum. You can be someone who's upset without assuming upsettedness only looks this way. One of the things that would happen when I get triggered is that I move straight into anger. Anger used to be one of my best friends. It's been a while since I've engaged with anger, and on occasion it happens, but to the point of kicking my car, punching a wall, slamming doors, breaking a dish, going into my car and driving really fast on a deserted road, hoping I die. I mean, there are so many avenues in which borderline took me down, but one of its favorites was anger. So I can understand in Trisha's brain when she says, I'm not upset. She's associating upsetness with only the extreme. But the dilemma of being self-aware is knowing that there is a spectrum to all of these things. You're allowed to be upset about not having creative freedom. But why you're upset is important. And to be honest, I think she wants more creative freedom anytime she feels like she might be replaced. And that correlates to the borderline. Because I, even as a borderline, but I'm in recovery, personally take Ethan's side with the way he's running the business because she's the one who's unreliable. And that's the issue. Just because someone's welcomed you into their home, just because you're dating their brother-in-law, just because you're showing up at family gatherings, doesn't necessarily mean you're an inner circle. An inner circle means you're trusted with responsibility. And Trisha is great at being responsible for just herself to whatever extent you want to claim responsibility, like her paying her bills and getting food and shelter. She can do the basics, which is great, right? Like, that's awesome. Remember, ones in my level scale of the levels, my observational philosophy, ones cannot be trusted with responsibility and can barely take care of themselves, if at all. And when they do it, it's not really taking care of themselves. Trisha, in many ways, is not really taking care of herself, but in many ways is extremely good at taking care of herself. And so you have to be very careful at how you're viewing this, because we don't know everything about her. I have no idea what Trisha's life is like behind camera. And though she shows a lot to us, I guarantee you there is stuff we are not seeing. And because of that, that's information that could change these answers. So I very distinctly put her as like a 2B who fluctuates. I think there is a point where Trisha could end up a 1, but I'm not sure she'll go down that path yet. I'm not quite ready to give up on her yet. I think there is a good chance she could stay a 2 and a good chance she could be very, very happy in her life. And that's what I want for her. That's what I want for all of them, is I do ultimately want them to all be happy. Here's the dilemma. A lot of the comments kept saying, I've never liked Trisha anyway. Get her off this channel. And it's true that when Trisha came in, slowly over time, Ethan and Neela became definitely more SJW, definitely more, they want to be good people. They really want to help people and help people like Trisha. But the reason why people like Trisha get to represent mental illness and make a horrible reputation for the rest of us is because she is in embracing her mental illness and allowing it to rule her. And so it makes good TV, or in this case, YouTube. So Ethan and Ela have great, sympathy. They want to be there for her and understand her. And because she's the one who's fucked up, they're giving her all these passes. But eventually they're going to have to say, Trisha, I'm open, but I have boundaries. Say it with me, kids. I'm open, but I have boundaries. So what's the difference between having boundaries and abandoning the people we love? They look very same to the mentally ill. They look the very same to a lot of people. I really fucking hate all the people in the comment sections who are like, Ethan, you said you were never going to abandon Trisha. How can you abandon Trisha? And I'm sitting here like, hey, bitches, just because he's not working with her doesn't mean he's abandoning her. They're still family by marriage, right? Just because, he's taking a stand and making his boundaries clear doesn't mean he's abandoning Trisha. It means he's making his boundaries clear. This is why I say Ethan cannot put boundaries on Trisha. He must put boundaries on himself. He cannot say, Trisha, I demand that when you come to work, you act this way. What he can say is, Trisha, based off of my needs and the needs of this company, the company has boundaries of how its employees act. And every employee, no matter who they are, needs to bring this energy to work. And that's putting the boundary on the company. And then the people who fit that boundary can apply. And Trisha, if she doesn't meet those requirements, is probably just not well suited for this industry. Well, not industry, podcast with H3H3. So that's the thing, right? We're all looking at this like it's so black and white. Oh, just talk it out. How are you going to talk it out with a person who literally sees reality different from you? You have to find common ground. So that's the dilemma I'm having. When Trisha said she wanted her sister to be thrown into the mix, can I be honest with you? That's such a bad idea. That's such a bad idea. She just wants her sister there to literally validate her crazy. Because that's what a sister will do. Your sister will do that. And one of the things I've learned watching my dad's business, and watching my own, is that like when you mix family in, you're really taking a risk, because it's just a different energy, guys. It's a different energy. And honestly, at this point, no one in my family really recommends it. My dad doesn't recommend it. Like my dad, literally all of his kids, like it just made it worse trying to work with our dad versus like the people who work with him now. Like we love them. We know them. They're actually homies of ours, but they work better with my dad than his own kids. Because again, family, it makes lines confusing, but for some families it works. I don't know if this is going to be one of those cases. Sometimes I think in order for Trisha to remain a healthy sort of person, it's better for her to have the stability of like their friendship over business. Because you'll notice every time things go wrong, she's always afraid that like, oh, now I have to break up with Moses. Girl, relax, okay? Just like chill. This is not a normal person conversation. Nothing happening between Ethan and Trisha is normal. This is all what happens when you're talking to mentally ill people. Because it's so clearly not normal. And that's what I'm trying to say. The reason Seattle kept fucking up my brain was because it didn't acknowledge that this isn't normal. It kept saying, well, this is your normal because you're mentally ill. And I'm like, ooh, I don't like that. We should strive for healthier brains and then accept what we can't change and make the best out of that. And then explain our limitations to people. you know, I don't like the way her audience is partially validating her, because my assumption is that they are also fucked up and mentally ill and not better. Because you'll notice the comments that are trying to hold her accountable still are like, Trisha, I'm borderline. I get what you're doing. Stop self-sabotaging. Stop doing what you're doing. And she's like, no, this has nothing to do with my borderline. And I'm like, okay, Trisha, whatever. It almost becomes like tediously annoying because she sits on this high horse of like, look at all everything I've done. How can I be wrong? But to give you some hope, third way she's gotten better, I just remembered. Oh, sorry. Oh my gosh. I'm just like, what's happening? Okay. Third thing I've noticed where she's getting better is she actually did say, I don't want to be this problem. I'm going to remove myself. So here's the two-part dilemma to this. One, she could actually realize she is the problem. Or two, because she doubled down, is actually using it to inflate her ego to say, I'm such a good person. I made sure to state that I could be the bad guy, which makes people think I said I am the bad guy, which makes it look like I'm being held accountable by myself. But really, I'm not. To say, I don't ever want to be rude. I'm never rude. Ask anyone I've worked with. I am not rude. And then to say, like, this is the last thing I'd want them to think of me as rude. And then you have five or six people telling you, yo, you're rude.
Talks about it, like, during the Oscars and... I don't know.
Is there a third pizza?
You're so not good about this. Okay, let's go to your stupid... I don't like this segment. Just for the record, fan advice is a stupid segment.
Why?
But we can do it. It's so dumb. What's the point?
To give advice to our fans?
But that's not the... That's like when people run out of ideas and they start doing Q&As. Like Tyler Oakley ran ideas. So it's like, we're going to do Q&As now because we have nothing else to talk about. Okay, go ahead. It's such a dumb segment.
It's so not. It's
like
fun.
We have nothing
sometimes...
to fill the time.
Okay, well, what, you want to talk more about Brokeback Mountain, a movie from fucking like
it's
10 years ago?
It's like a lazy podcast. Like, we're going to play games on the, like, you know.
A lazy podcast. You don't do anything for it. You just show up. We do all the work.
Oh, my God. Yeah, right.
When you don't give validation to people who are wrong, look at how they treat you. Because if they can't truly make amends for the things they have done and learn from their mistakes, then they're not getting better. Now, every person has to make a decision for how much they want to be involved. As an example, Ethan has to make a decision how much more he's gonna wait for Trisha to get better. This is why I tell you that I have an inner circle. It specifies to the world, I have no fucking obligation to you if you are not in my inner circle. Not one where I sacrifice my sleep to come get you at 2 a.m. because you're having a panic attack in the middle of the street, right? No offense, I've known a lot of crazy people over the years, and I'm not going to lie. I used to live in a part of Seattle that had, like, sex workers drunk and high off their ass walking middle of the street half naked. And I'm going to be real. It was a really dangerous part of town. Like, people definitely were warned not to walk around because people could come and pick you up. And it was one of those things where, you know, I sat there and I'm like, what is my moral obligation to this? Am I supposed to go pick up that girl and save her? But the truth is like, no. A big part of life is just acknowledging that we're still in the wild, wild west. We just have Amazon stores now. Like, we're still in the wild, wild west, whether or not you're holding your iPhone or not. And society over time has gotten so much better and safer. But if you think there are parts of this population that aren't fucking running around the streets right now, like, come on. And we can't save them all. So, no, I don't feel obligated to save that stranger. And at the same time, I don't feel obligated to save people who are somewhat in my life either, unless they're in my inner circle. Then I'm willing to put up with you. I have someone who's a number one in my inner circle, and I'm still going to be there for them when they decide to make contact again. But I'm open and I have boundaries. Open, but I have boundaries. And that's the thing, is I make it clear that, like, you're allowed to be yourself. You're allowed to be crazy and neurotic and manic and hurt people around you, but I'm not going to be one of the people you get to hurt. You know, I have a limit. I totally see you. I feel you. I love you. But like, homie, I got a limit. And at this point, especially since they're often grown people who claim, oh, you know, it's your life that's awful. It's not my life. I'm not the problem. You're the problem. It's just at one point too exhausting. And Trisha is making the assumption, because Ethan said he would never leave her, that she's in her circle. And that's the thing. Does Ethan understand what he said to her? That's why I tell you people, stop saying you're going to be there for mentally ill people. Because the truth is that you're really not going to be when it matters. You know, it's easy to say that when shit's going okay or when the problem's like kind of minute. But you really got to be careful when you say it, because they're going to remember it and they're going to make you their favorite person, or they're going to cling to you. Like, one of the things that was very clear to me growing up was that even though I felt abandoned and constantly like, you know, just I wanted more than anything the love of my family, and I felt like I wasn't getting it because I was queer. One of the things that changed was the fact that when I got better, I went home and I showed them that I was better, to the point where it made, you know, all of us better by all getting better and growing up and all making a choice. Like, my family made a choice to work together. And now, like, Marcus and I, who are the two out queer kids, and then my sister's bisexual, she came out too, is like, we can all be home. It still bothers my parents, like, they're Catholic, but they tell us all the time, like, there's never a reason why you can't come home to us. There's nothing you could do that would make us really never want to see you again. It's just so beautiful. But that meant I had to do a lot of work. They had to do a lot of work. It's not just validating mentally ill people that helps them get better. If that was it, it'd be super easy to go on Twitter and tell everyone they're a goddess. But it's not that easy. You have a literal issue. It's an issue. So it's gonna be your problem, like the mentally ill person's problem. Now, of course, if you have a mental illness or some sort of psychotic episode in which you don't even know you're having it, then yes, the people in your life are gonna look at you and say, holy shit, we have to step up now and be there. But with moments like this, these things can be avoided, you know, if the people around them are well informed. So you can have the happy ending that I got, but you all have to work together. You can have the happy ending I have if you acknowledge, for the most important thing to acknowledge is that if you're the person with the BPD or the mental illness, you're automatically the person who has to do the most work. And I don't want to hear any conversation about it's not fair. I don't want to hear any of that shit. I don't hear 5-year-olds with cancer talking about how life's not fair. I don't want to hear 40-year-old women with borderline talking about it. I don't give a fuck about fairness. If life was fair, it just wouldn't be life. You know what I mean? It wouldn't be real. It'd be some sort of fantasy. And I'm not interested in a fantasy. I want to live in the most reality. I've lived most of my life confused about what's real. I most certainly don't want to live the rest of my life that way. Read books. Educate yourself. If you find yourself getting triggered watching a YouTube video, the problem is with you, not the person making the video. And remember, that is a great indicator. Your brain is telling you something's wrong. Something's wrong. Go get help. Calm down and go get help when you're ready. Trisha is not a bad person, meaning she's not evil, malicious. She's not fucking Hitler. But is she uneducated? Yes. Is she naive? Yes. Is she completely egotistical? Yes. Is she really super confused about what's happening in life? Yes. I do believe she's going to therapy, but here's what I know about mentally ill people in therapy, myself included. My first therapist had to deal with this. They are not always able to be forthcoming in therapy. And so Trisha, I think, is getting therapy, but I think she's getting probably subpar therapy because she's probably not able to be completely honest with her therapist. I hope she's really doing DBT. I hope she's not relying completely on medication. And I hope she understands that when you're on medication, it's like you have to do so much to make sure you're not fucking up that medication. As an example, when I was going to therapy with my good therapist, the one I liked who helped me, she told me to stop drinking. And I said, really? And she goes, well, every time you get suicidal, you drink and you smoke, but you mostly drink. At the time, I was heavily drinking. Every time I was like depressed, I would just like chug back alcohol and go try to drown myself in the bathtub. So she's like, okay, let's stop drinking. And I was like, oh. She goes, do you know alcohol is a depressant? And I'm like, well, yeah. And she goes, no. Do you understand that alcohol is a depressant? And I was like, oh. She goes, let's see if you have chronic depression, or let's see if it's a symptom of the borderline. So I went like 3.5 years without drinking. 3.5 years, I got the DBT. I went traveling. I still smoked pot. Pot was allowed. And then I slowly introduce alcohol back into my system. And I only drink it like once a year, every 6 months or something. If like there's 4th of July or like a party, or my brother came over before he left for the military and he's like, drink, drink, drink. And so that was when I broke my fast, because I was like, yeah, I guess I'm ready to see. Good news, alcohol does not impact me negatively. Good news, I'm not chronically depressed. It's actually just a symptom of the borderline. Good news, by eliminating something from my life, I was able to see if it was actually the reason that was causing me more anxiety. Same thing with people. We need to do this with people. Eliminate them out of our lives and move on. We need to do this with, you know, to reach that happy ending. I know it makes me cry every time I think about it, but it's just because I'm so relieved. Like, 15-year-old Brittany is still living in my head, like, freaking out all the time. Like, oh, my God, is your mom going to find your OnlyFans and, like, abandon you? Oh, is your dad going to be completely disappointed? And at the same time, I know ultimately my parents know what I do, but they don't know what I do. They would be mortified. They would be really upset for a really long time. But at my core, I know they will never abandon me, ever. Because they never have. In every way I processed abandonment, it was only sort of true. Because remember, I knew I was queer when I was a little kid. So hearing all their anti-gay rhetoric made me think like, oh shit, I'm going to have to kill myself one day, or I'm going to be abandoned anyway. And I grew up at a time when like you really couldn't be gay in public, versus now everything's gay. Everyone's gay. Everything's gay. Everyone's queer. Everyone's trans. Everyone's everything. So it's very welcoming. You know what I mean? I wouldn't have had my life any other way, because it is what it was. But I know so much of me recovering was having that inner circle. So even though in my head I thought I was being abandoned, a part of me knew I wasn't to some extent, because I didn't kill myself. You know what I mean? So because I had that inner circle, I think it kept me alive and it helped me get sane faster. So what do people with mental illness, especially like borderline, do when they don't have that? I think those are the people who need the most help, because they have no resources. But how do you know they don't have resources? Because I've met a lot of people who go, I have no resources. But they do. They just don't believe they have them. And this is why I say, like, it's not our job to say Ethan shouldn't be there for Trisha, or Trisha should do this X, Y, and Z. I don't know the details of their life. But what I do know is that if Trisha does not believe she has an inner circle, she might continue spiraling until she really believes it. Do you guys remember, like, my sister literally got a tattoo of me on her arm, and I remember sharing it on YouTube. It's me of a mermaid, because I love the ocean and I'm a mermaid baby, and she's getting it removed now. And I remember asking her, like, why did you get this in the first place? She goes, you were so suicidal and you were so sad in Seattle and you were spiraling so much, and I just thought it would make you feel better. And I was like, and I remember I was having a borderline episode when she showed it to me. I was crying in my living room. I was paying our rent. I was dating my ex, who was just the worst thing for my mental health. And we had gotten into a fight and he was in the room locked, and I was in my living room just sleeping on the floor in a pile of covers. And my sister goes, hey, I did something for you and I really want to show you. And I was like, I'm a mess right now. I'm spiraling. I'm in depression. I don't know what's going on. This is before I got diagnosed with borderline. And I'm sitting there. I'm like, I don't know what's going on. I just feel awful. And then she goes, can I please, please just like open up your computer and like Skype me. So we Skyped, and then she goes, Fushum! And she shows me her arm, and it's literally me as a mermaid. And you know, it's such a stupid gesture, because she marked her beautiful body with my ugly fucking face. But at the same time, I was moved. I felt so loved. And it was like a physical reminder of that love. And I told her, I was like, oh my God, did you really get me tattooed? And she goes, yes, isn't it so pretty? And yes, it was. But now that I'm better, and now that she's moving on with her life, she's realizing like how awkward that was when she's like dating people and they're like, so is your sister dead? Is that a memorial tattoo? She's like, no. And then obviously people are like looking at me as like a half naked mermaid on her arm. We realized how weird it was. But at the time, it just felt like it would make me feel better. It was just such a weird, you know what I mean? We always do things to make people in our lives feel better. But until you understand mental health, you'll understand most of these actions are just band-aids. Validating Trisha, making her feel like a person, validating her body. You know, every time she calls Ethan skinny, watch the way she says it. It's like she's waiting for him to also say, you look skinny. You know what I'm saying? Trisha had that segment about Eugenia Cooney where she was like, in my head, I know it's not okay, but in my head, I keep thinking she looks better thin. Trisha is a mentally ill person. Do you get what I'm saying? Trisha has problems. Stop holding Trisha to the same standard as like a neurotypical person. And at the same time, make sure the goal for her is to get as close to that standard as possible. And this is the problem. Okay. Her comment sections, especially for the Eugenia Cooney video, were like, I can't believe Trisha said this. You do not see Trisha Paytas. You. If you are shocked that Trisha said that, then you do not understand Trisha Paytas. You think being fat is an eating disorder because you've been convinced that it's somehow a choice. But it is the same as anorexia. It's the other side of being anorexic. It is the other side. If you do not understand that getting obese, morbid obese, to the point where you have diabetes or amputating your legs, to the point where your life is being stunted, to the point where you're so fat you can't get up off a beach to rescue your kid who's drowning in the ocean, to the point where you have no chance of being fast enough to catch it, this is a problem. Did you see that Tess Holliday came out as anorexic? Do you get what I'm saying? These are mentally ill people. And you're looking at them like they're going to know better. But if they're mentally ill and on top of that don't have the education, why would they know better? Why? Like, why would they know better? I was not shocked. Actually, I was relieved. When Trisha said she thought Eugenia Cooney kind of looked good, I was relieved because she's saying something so honestly true for so many of you. All those girls who watch Instagram and they're like, oh, Instagram fucks with me. I get it. It could fuck with me sometimes too, which is why I don't spend more than 5 minutes a day on it, because I get on there, I do my work, and I get off. If I wasn't a public person, why would you be on Instagram? Like, that's the thing. It's to view other people living lives you wish you could have instead of getting off your ass and having that life. And that's the key, is acknowledging, again, that technology is not the issue. Don't shut down Instagram because you have no self-control. Instead, have so much self-control that there's no need for an Instagram. I'm not mad that Trisha Paytas is fucked up, because I don't hold her to a standard of a person who's not fucked up. But I also know how she's negatively impacted the people around her, and that's Ethan and Ella. I really hope that their family is sticking together. I really hope Ethan has a support system right now, and I hope Trisha has Moses, because it's very hard when you're triggered not to have somebody. So I'm glad she has Moses. But on the other side, it's really hard for neurotypical people or the people who are on the other side of a borderline tantrum to handle what's being said because it's so confusing and contradictory. So please have enough empathy, or at least sympathy, for everyone involved. And stop objectifying Trisha. Stop living vicariously through her. Stop justifying her life because she has money. And please remember that even though all of, you know, the fact that she can take care of herself makes her mess valid, it's not your business. And I mean this for you. I don't mean this like you should make a video about it. I'm making a video right now. What I'm saying is, like, it shouldn't impact your life. Please do not live through Trisha. Trisha's really messed up, guys. She's had a horrible life. She's been assaulted many times. She's been abused. She's used her body for clout and moving up the ladder. She's used her psych, like her literal mania for views. She, like Gabby, right? Like, I don't know why you think these aren't all similar kinds of people. Stop engaging. You can make content that is beneficial to them if you have resources you can offer, if you can offer something more. But don't go out of your way and sacrifice your happiness for a YouTube personality that's never going to listen to you. I know. I see you in the comments. Trisha, please get help. Trisha, please. You can keep doing that. But if you're like me, just a reminder to yourself, do not lose sleep over it. Because I know I have the tendency to do that, and I'm assuming you do too, maybe. But I literally could not sleep because I was thinking of Trisha. And then I was like, Brittany, Trisha's never going to talk to you. You're not going to be able to help Trisha. You need to calm down. And it's awful because, like, you want to. You want to be like, hey, homie, you could be so happy. But the thing is, unless Trisha sits down and starts to read a book, maybe she can't be. And maybe overall that's fine for her and her universe. You know, you can enjoy content from a distance too, guys. You're allowed to watch Trisha and Ethan and not get involved, you know? So all of these are options. I'm not saying there's one clear answer. I'm saying all of these things are options. Know yourself in order to help yourself. Same with Trisha. God, I feel like I have so many things I could say. But I think that's the end of it. I think that's really the end of it. Man. I think I do feel the worst, though, for Ethan. Because I love him, but he's such a bottom boy. And he's just going to white. He just doesn't know how to not white knight. And then when he stands up for himself, he doesn't know how to do it. So it looks like he's an asshole. But honestly, like, I'm proud of him for having that moment where he just, like, wasn't having it that day. And sometimes you got to do that. And you got to do it because you need it for yourself. You know? What a mess. What a fucking mess. All right, guys. Thank you so much for watching. I really hope this podcast came out okay. I feel very insecure about it. But I'm sure it's lovely. Have a lovely day. I feel overall very good about this situation. I don't think this is the last time we'll see Frenemies. I think it would be good for Trisha to take 3 or so months off and go do DBT and be secluded. But I don't think she'll do it. So I'm sure we'll see her again. But if you want to know my ultimate opinion, she needs 3 to 6 months off of the internet. She can't rely on it. She has to learn to not rely on it. And then she needs to be by herself. That's why I left the internet initially. Sorry, one last tangent. Here's a Middle Eastern goodbye for you, where we just keep talking even though we've said goodbye. I needed time away from the internet to know if I really wanted to do it because it's so hard. I mean, I literally deal with so much behind the scenes of just like anxiety. And, you know, I had to learn to balance that out. And a lot of it is just like not being on the internet all the time. One of the reasons I keep Twitter just to like happy stuff, like OF stuff, 18 plus, is because I don't want to yell at people. Like, I don't want to yell with people over Twitter. I used to spend hours a day on Twitter arguing with people, and I don't do that anymore. Again, 10 minutes a day tops on Twitter, maybe 5, you know, but 10 minutes tops. I don't allow myself any more time online in that regard because, again, it's, I don't want to do it. I'd rather do anything else. I'd rather watch anime. I'd rather get, you know, baked. I'd rather hang out with my brothers. I'd rather play Smash. I'd rather read a book. Like, I'd rather do so many other things than live on Twitter. But the thing is I remember being obsessed with Twitter and thinking this was really connecting with people and I was really having a moment with people and I could move people and help people and be amazing. And nope, that stuff does not happen on Twitter. Look at Trisha going crazy on Twitter and everyone getting involved. It's just not healthy. This is not healthy. We need a solid meditation retreat for Trisha. No phone. Just, or if, you know, she has a phone, it's without the internet. But like, you need to go back to your roots, people. We need to go back to the earth. We need to go back to not minimalism like the movement, but like getting all the things out of our life that are chaotic and noisy that are not actually bringing us joy. And yeah, I think that's definitely what's needed. Gosh. But, you know, this is what happens when people get on the internet and they think that they can be super. I don't know. Like, what are they thinking? Like, that's what I'm saying. Like, I love how Trisha and Ethan went on this whole rampage over David Dobrik and all these people. And I'm just looking at them like, do you not know you're the same people? You manipulate. You expose your mental illnesses for views. You expose other people for views. You share private text messages. You talk shit on everyone. How are you fucking different? And that's why I love both David Dobrik's group and Trisha and Ethan. Because even though I think they're all hot messes, I see that they're not all actually malicious or cruel. They're just dumb. Yeah, dumb. That's what it is. This is what happens when dumb people get money. Okay, guys, that's it. I think that's what it is. Maybe that's why I'm like having a hard time understanding how they can make these decisions. But then I remember like I was dumb, like way dumber than I am now. But see, I still didn't. I did somewhat make these decisions, but I stopped really fast. And I think it's because my therapist said, like, not all, like, it's the high functioning thing, but it's because I read. I'm telling you, there's a reason why, even though I've had moments of being upset and almost spilling secrets, I never really do. And because I never really do, like, that's the hard part when people go, this is what borderline is. And I look at Trisha and I don't feel like I identify with her struggle all the way. It's confusing to me. But then I realize, like, this is what happens when you have a spectrum of mental illness. People hear borderline and they think of Trisha. I look at Trisha and I'm like, I get like, yeah, I see parts of myself in her, but like, I'm 32 too, right? Isn't she 32? Isn't she my age? And I got way better way faster and I had no money. I had no money to do this. I just had to. I had gotten fired and that was my moment where I was like, oh, Brittany, you don't get fired. You've never gotten fired. And when I got fired, it's like, something is super wrong. This is not okay. But Trisha, she hasn't hit rock bottom. All of the things Trisha's been through, she has not hit rock bottom. And that's what's crazy is, oh my God, what is this woman's rock bottom? Because it's going to look crazy. You know what I mean? It's probably going to be what Gabby's is. Like, Gabby's rock bottom is happening, and, like, Gabby is swimming in her rock bottom, and I don't know if she's ever going to get out of it. Oh, so sad. Okay, talk to you guys soon. Thank you for watching. Go read a book. It will make you feel better. Doesn't matter what it is, go read a book. Trust me. Or listen to an audiobook. Trust me. All right, talk to you soon. Have a great, great day. Bye, guys.
My head in real life while I'm in bed, my belly's being fed and I'm okay. I'm just fine, yet all I do is whine, not to you in my mind, cause I know I don't make sense. I've been nothing but blessed, so why's my life a mess? Please tell me, cause I'm sick of thinking, yeah, I'm sick of reaching out for the truth and living life as a fool. Dun, 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 dun. Da